If you can be with this on me, I was seeing something in the Word. And man, Old Testament, aren't you glad that our God is the same yesterday, today, and forever? And the New Testament didn't come along and do away with the Old Testament completely. The God of the Old Testament, he's the same God, isn't he? And you know what? I'm so glad that I can know him in a very wonderful way. And we'll get into this tonight. But man, there's so many sides to him. When you think about him being Lord, there's so many different aspects of his lordship. And it's very important. You know, you can you think about some of these really famous athletes and stuff, and they have kids, and their kids will know them, you know, at home as daddy. But boy, when you see them doing what they're made to do, you know, when they're I don't know, I think of something like Mike Tyson or something. It's like, you know, he might be kind of a teddy bear at home, but you don't want to get him in a ring, right? He's a different, but he's still Mike Tyson. And, you know, I think that's there's so much about our God that the more we get exposed to other aspects of him, it actually helps us to honor him and to fear him and to respect him the way he needs to be, right? So I want to talk tonight about knowing God. Let me see here. I got the wrong thing up. Let me bring up the right thing here. Knowing he is Lord. How many know he's Lord? We could sing that song. He is Lord. He is Lord. He has risen from the dead and he is Lord. Well, that's not the only reason why he's Lord. He's Lord in a lot of different ways. I'm so grateful that he's risen from the dead. Amen. So I'm just going to go through several of these. I got some scriptures I want to use to draw out from this. because in the Old Testament, a lot of times it says, and then they will know that I am Lord. So that means that there's a way that you know that he's Lord based upon an experience of him somehow. And so we'll draw some stuff out of that, and then how we can actually know him ourselves. That's very precious. So the five ways I have here, and you might be able to get some more, but I thought, well, these are ones that we can talk about anyway. And I'm going to relate all these to, if you're going to behold God, you're going to behold his glory, right? This is who he is. So each one of these is another way of beholding the glory of God. All right? So demonstrations of his power. He could do some amazing things. He can split the sea. He can do all kinds of things like that. And when he does, think, that's God. That's God. Nobody else can do that. That's God. He's the Lord. And then you know that he's God, right? All right. He can do it by devastating judgments. You know what? He defeats his enemies. And in the light of some of the things that are going on in the world today, so as my wife and I were talking in the kitchen the other day, and we say, when is justice going to happen? You know, in the world? It's like, when are things going to be shown to be what? You know what? There's an end to it. And God's going to be proven. And he actually is a God of judgment. It's very important to be on the right side of God. There's actually a hell reserved for those. And Jesus said there'd be weeping and gnashing of teeth. There's going to be, well, that's another side of, that's part of what makes him Lord, is the justice, the judgments, right? Okay? Fulfilled statements. He's a prophetic God. When he says something, it's going to happen. And when you see it happen, you think, he's Lord, right? Because he said something and it happened, right? And man, you can take a lot of these, you can get pretty deep into these, but supernatural provision. This is the side we like, right? The good side of God. He's going to take care of us. He's going to meet all of our needs, right? It can look like different things. It can look like healing. It can look like, you know, financial provision. But when you see it happening, you say, he's the Lord, right? And you know it in a different way when you experience it. It's good to know it by faith, but man, when you see it happen, man, helps you to know in a different way, okay? And then this last one is where I want to get to, is you can know him face to face. You can know him because you actually behold his nature, his goodness, okay? And I'm going to contrast these a little bit because anybody can know that he's the Lord. The world, all the world is going to know, right? They're going to see that he's actually the Lord. But there's a better side to it, okay? So let's go through demonstrations of his power. I'm just going to go through some examples here out of the Old Testament. Most of this is the Old Testament. And it's amazing how many references bring this out. When this happens, then they'll know. And the implication is, until this happens, they don't really know. And I want us to be encouraged in this because there's a side to knowing God, to knowing that he's Lord, that has everything to do with our faithfulness to behold his glory. And when we're beholding his glory, I think it's very important to be able to peer into the other aspects of who he is for it to really cause us to tremble in his presence. That's a necessity. Amen? So let's look at some of the demonstrations of his power here. This is Exodus 6:6. Therefore, say to the people of Israel, I am the Lord. I will free you from your oppression, and I will rescue you from your slavery in Egypt. I will redeem you with a powerful arm and great acts of judgment. I will claim you as my own people, and I will be your God. Then you will know that I am the Lord your God, who has freed you from your oppression in Egypt. Now just think about this. This is the God of creation talking through Moses, right? He's saying he's going to do these things. And just a question. Do you think the people actually knew that he was God yet? Not according to this. It said, then you'll know. Right? He's actually making a prophetic statement. So I was thinking about this because these are people that don't have any books written yet for them to refer to. They've heard some stories about Abraham, about Isaac, but where have they been for 400 years? Is there a God, period? Especially, is there a Lord, right? Because they've been in slavery for 400 years. And this guy shows up out of the wilderness, this guy that killed an Egyptian for pretending like he was going to deliver them. And now he starts spouting off this stuff about what God is saying. And I don't know about you, but even, you know, you're growing up a slave, man, you just start scratching your head, you know, is this really God? Now, we can say, I want us to try to relate to this to some extent because this God that we know, we can still be diverted from really knowing him and the fullness of how he is until we behold him. There's something about beholding him that is necessary. Amen? I believe we can do it by the Spirit. I believe he can help us to see these things about him by the Spirit. But what is he doing? He's saying, I'm going to deliver you, and then... It's kind of interesting that he even had to say that. But I think it was very important that he did. So that when they're beholding these things, they say, oh, he said that. And there's actually a combination to his statements and the beholding of them that actually causes knowing to take place. Okay? Let's look at another one here. Exodus 7:5. When I raise my powerful hand and bring out the Israelites, the Egyptians will know. Even the oppressors will know. Right? What? That I am the Lord. Was he ever at one point not the Lord? No, but something had to happen for them to know it. Right? Okay. Let's go to Exodus 14:18. When my glory, there's always the stipulation, when, right? When my glory, what's he talking about? He's talking about glory, he's talking about his presence, he's talking about his power, right? Is displayed, through them, all Egypt will see what? My glory. So we're gonna get to it later about beholding the glory of God, but beholding the glory of God has a lot of different perspectives, a lot of different sides to it, doesn't it? Because you know who he's talking about here is the Egyptian soldiers. We'll see my glory and know what? That I am the Lord. He's talking about the glory of God being displayed through his enemies. Isn't that interesting? And what took place in that? He's talking about them getting swallowed up by the ocean or by the sea, right? And that was a display of his glory. It's bringing judgment at the same time, but it's a demonstration of his power in an amazing way. And you just got to sit back and say, huh, he's the Lord, right? In a way that you couldn't have before. Is that right? And it's interesting that God actually used people. He used Moses for this too, right? Moses had to participate in it. But God is displaying his glory through actually his enemies at this point. I think that's interesting, don't you? In a display of his power. 1 Samuel 17:46. Today, I like this one. This is a little kid, right? You know what? I thought it was so special. This David and Goliath story is so amazing. Because a lot of times, God will take somebody that it's just impossible for them to do it, just so that you'll know that he did it. Don't you? Right? And he actually says it in this statement. It's really cool. Today the Lord will conquer you. I like how everything is put together in these statements. Today the Lord will conquer you and I will kill you. Don't you like that? He puts himself right in cahoots with God. Right? And I will kill you and cut off your head. That's impossible. And then I will give the dead bodies. Man, he's graphic. This is a boy. Where did he get? He wasn't watching movies like they do today. I mean, where did he get all this stuff, you know? And then I will give the dead bodies of your men to the birds and wild animals. And the whole world then, what? Will know that there is a God in Israel. Man, I just want to have God in the sweet moments of worship. Aren't you glad that this is the kind of God he is? Because you know what he is? He's a God of righteousness. He's a God of justice. And he uses an impossible participant so that you know that it's him. And what's so cool about David is he's fully aware that when he stands out there, God's going to do something. All right, we'll get to it a little bit. I believe there's a reason why there's certain figures from the Old Testament that did not divert from their relationship, from their belief. They didn't fall. David, Moses, Abraham, some of these. And we're going to look at what I believe is why. Because it's not enough. Let's go back to the statement that God was going to deliver them from Egypt, right? What happened when he did? All these plagues, everything that happened, and then getting to go across, and the soldiers were swallowed up in the sea. Who saw all that? All these Israelites. And here's the thing about knowing that he's Lord. It's fickle. It can be very fickle. Man, we used to have testimony services all the time in church, you know. And sister would stand up and give the same one every time. 20 years ago, I was gloriously saved. Yeah, you know. And There is that moment. There's that event of seeing the glory. I believe that's how salvation is. It's beholding the glory of God, this amazing concept that God loves me so much that he forgives me of all my sins. And it washes over you. In that moment, you behold him and you know him. It's amazing. And then you go out into the world and you behold a bunch of other junk, right? And it can become fickle. And that's what happened to them in the wilderness. It became, no sooner do they get delivered from the sea than they start bellyache about some other stuff, right? Because knowing him is something that has to be maintained. And I believe this is going to be something that we can get to, that this is why it sets some people apart. We can actually lose our knowing of him. Amen? All right. Not so be it, but that can happen. Right. Okay, and David just he just isn't it gonna be cool to see him and maybe get some replays? And everyone assembled here will know that the Lord rescues his people. Don't you like that? That the Lord, they're gonna know that he's Lord and that he takes care of his people, right? But not with sword and spear. This is the Lord's battle, and he will give you to us. Don't you like that? Now, he's the one that's going to go up there and use his own sword to cut his head off after he knocks him out with a stone, right? But he says, everything that's happening is God. You're going to see God. You're going to see God's glory here today. Aren't you glad for people that step up there and do that? And that doesn't come unless you're actually beholding him. It came from David because he's beholding him all the time, right? Okay, 1 Kings 18:37. Oh, Lord, answer me. Okay, remember what happened with Elijah? They had the 400 prophets of Baal, right? And here's the thing. Again, the fickleness of knowing God by the children of Israel. Because they were actually wavering. Why were they wavering? Because they had a relationship with the people, the local people. And because they were being persuaded, all these people believed in Baal. Maybe Baal's not so bad. Maybe he's just as good as our God. What does our God have that Baal doesn't have? And so it came down to a demonstration, competition. And Elijah, remember what happened? They got out there and they cut themselves and they bellyached before their gods and nothing happened, right? And then Elijah has a whole bunch of water poured over it, and there's a calf put out on the altar, and then he prays this prayer. Don't you like this? Let's look at this. Oh Lord, he addresses him as Lord right up front. That means he already knows, right? The people not so much, but he does. Answer me. Answer me so these people will know. Isn't this cool? And this is the God we serve. He's a God of demonstration. He's a God of power. He can do all things, right? Answer me so these people will know that you, O Lord, are God, and that you have brought them back to yourself. Isn't that precious? Immediately, the fire of the Lord... Aren't you glad he didn't wait for a while? So it was like, oh man, come on. No, it happened right away. God answered right away, didn't he? Immediately the fire of the Lord flashed down from heaven and burned up the young bull, the wood, the stones, and the dust. It even licked up all the water in the trench. Now, what was that? That was the glory of God, wasn't it? They were beholding. All these people were beholding the glory of God coming down in fire and burning up all this stuff in a way that was impossible. And when all the people saw it, what happened to their hearts? They believed, didn't they? They fell face down on the ground and cried out, "The Lord, he is God. Yes, the Lord is God." Don't you like that? How did that happen? It's a demonstration of power, right? Okay. Can you take some more here? One more with the power side, all right? Isaiah 43:10. But you are my witnesses, O Israel, says the Lord. You are my servant. You have been chosen to know me, believe in me, and understand that I alone am God. There is no other God. There never has been, and there never will be. I am the Lord, and there is no other Savior. First, I predicted. Now, look at this. So he's given some of the reasons why. First, I predicted your rescue. I didn't just rescue you. I told you I would. There's something powerful about that, isn't there? About his word. You can actually behold his glory in his word, right? Then I saved you and proclaimed it to the world. No foreign God has ever done this. You are witnesses that I am the only God, says the Lord. What's a witness? That's somebody that's beheld what God has done. Isn't that great? Man, so much. I had to weed out. I know there's a lot here, but I had to weed out so much because there's so much about this. In Isaiah, but man, Ezekiel. How many like Ezekiel? Ezekiel's a scary book. There's a whole bunch of judgment. So we're going to look at judgment from Ezekiel a little bit. But I'm telling you, over and over again, I'm just going to judge your enemies. I'm gonna judge you for turning your back on me. There's all this stuff because there's judgment. He's a God of judgment, isn't he? Ezekiel 7:27. The king and the prince will stand helpless, weeping in despair, and the people's hands will tremble with fear. I will bring on them the evil they have done to others, and they will receive the punishment they so richly deserve. Then they will know. So there's a judgment that produces the beholding of God's glory. Yeah. Did you know that judgment is the beholding of glory? It is, yeah. Right? And then they will know. You know, we're going to get to this a little bit later, but there's a scripture that says, beholding the glory, we are changed from glory to glory. And sometimes I just want to be, I've always just imagined like a cloud, like a ball of fire. That's what I'm beholding. But you know what it is? It's also his judgments. Can you see that? All right. Ezekiel 28:26. See, we got a whole bunch of Ezekiel here, and I cut out a whole bunch too. All right. They will live safely in Israel and build homes and plant vineyards. This is the ones he's taking care of, right? And when, there's that word again. When I punish the neighboring nations that treated them with contempt, they will know that I am the Lord their God. Isn't that interesting? So he's already taken care of them. He's already provided something for them, right? But it's when the punishment comes. Isn't that interesting? When the judgment is taking place, that's when they actually are convinced of this. All right. Ezekiel 36:23. I will show how holy my great name is, the name on which you brought shame upon the nations. And when I reveal my holiness through you before their very eyes, says the sovereign Lord, then the nations will know that I am the Lord. Huh. He's talking to his people, isn't he? All right. Hebrews 12:28. Therefore, since we are receiving a kingdom which cannot be shaken. Now, this is bringing it home. This is the New Testament. We finally got to the New Testament, right? He's talking to us now, right? Let us have grace by which we may serve God acceptably. How? You cannot behold his glory, the wonderful things that we want to just feel so good about, without beholding that he's also doing this in reverence and godly fear, for our God is a consuming fire. That's what he is also. And actually, this does not need to be a negative thing. It can enhance our beholding of him. Can you see this? I would rather know about his judgments and make some adjustments. Judgments should come with adjustments, right? And they become helpful. They become wisdom for us, right? All right. He fulfilled statements. I got a few of these real quick, all right? Ezekiel, we're still in Ezekiel 37:12. So gladly, Ezekiel's not just about judgments, all right? He's also about fulfilled statements. Therefore, prophesy to them and say, this is what the sovereign Lord says, O my people, I will open your graves of exile and cause you to rise again. Don't you like what God says about his promised ones? There's good things, right? Then I will bring you back to the land of Israel. When there's the word, right? When this happens, O my people, you will know that I am the Lord. Again, what is the question? Do they know before? They might know some, but there's something they get when God's promise comes true. Amen? There's something about knowing that God will heal you. And there's something about knowing when you experience it. Amen? And it's not that you didn't believe before, but there's something that just comes in and it just settles in you, right? I will put my spirit in you and you will live again and return home to your own land. Then, that's kind of like when, isn't it? Then you will know that I, the Lord, have spoken, and I have done what I said. This is going into statements, isn't it? If God says it, it's going to happen. Yes, the Lord has spoken. There needs to be a connection of knowing him that's associated with a statement that he's made. Amen? Ezekiel 39:27. When I bring them home from the lands of their enemies, I will display my holiness among them for all the nations to see. Then my people will know that I am the Lord their God. Did I already read that? I did, didn't I? No, this is another one. Wait a second. No. Then my people will know that I am the Lord their God because I sent them away to exile. I did, didn't I? All right, I'm sorry. Let's go to Isaiah 45. See what I'm talking about? This fresh bread can kind of get foul a little bit once in a while. All right. Let all the world look to me for salvation, for I am God. There is no other. Isn't it amazing that God has to say this? You know, you'd think we'd just be able to, he could just take it for granted that we're noticing. But he actually says this, right? I have sworn by my own name. That means he's saying, What I'm saying, I'm confirming by even my name, right? I have spoken the truth, and I will never go back on my word. Every knee will bend to me, and every tongue will declare allegiance to me. And I'm thinking, you know what? Why? Because they will behold that what he said came to pass, and their knee will crumble. Everybody in the world today that is completely disregarding God, this is the thing that, man, this hit me when the COVID thing happened. Is anybody even considering what God has said about anything right now? No. Dr. Fauci, you know, whoever else. Is anybody even considering what God has to say? Because whether or not you consider it or not, it's going to happen. You are going to behold the glory of God when what he said comes to pass. And your proud knees are going to be groveling on the floor. All right. Isaiah 55. For as the rain comes down and the snow from heaven, and do not return there, but water the earth and make it bring forth and bud, that it may give seed to the sower and bread to the eater, so shall my word be that goes forth from my mouth. It shall not return to me void, but it shall accomplish what I please, and it shall prosper in the thing for which I sent it. And when that happens, behold the glory of God. I know this for people that are faithful in giving. They get to behold the glory of God because God prospers them in reciprocation for how much they give. Amen? All right, provision. Let's look at provision. Are y'all good? Yeah. All right, there's a lot of this in there. Provision, Exodus 16:12. I have heard the Israelites' complaints. Now tell them, in the evening you will have meat to eat And in the morning, you will have all the bread you want. Then, when I provide it for you, then you're going to know that I am the Lord. Again, there's this necessity of beholding God's working, his provision. There needs to be, when you do behold that, that there is a settling of a greater knowing of who he is, of his lordship. Because this needs to be secured in us to where our fickleness gets lost in faith. Amen? Isaiah 49, 23. Kings and queens will serve you and care for all your needs. That means you've risen to the top. People are actually taking care of you. Man, this is an adjustment of you know, there's people that expect this all the time because that's how they live. But when you grow up not having that stuff and you feel like you're it's an whole adjustment of thinking. God's saying, you're my child. And we get, in the New Testament, we get he calls us kings and priests, right? They will bow to the earth before you and lick the dust from your feet. Man, I don't know if I want that or not, but then you will know, all right? We're beholding the glory, right? Those who trust in me will never be put to shame. Isn't that a good promise? Yes. How many want to behold the glory of God? Yes. Amen. Ezekiel 20:42. Man, we got a lot of Ezekiel. I'm sorry. Then, when I have brought you home to the land I promised with a solemn oath to give to your ancestors, you will know that I am the Lord. Yes. All right, here's another one. Ezekiel 20:44. You will know that I am the Lord, O people of Israel, when, man, so many of these wins, I have honored my name by treating you mercifully in spite of your wickedness. Isn't that wonderful? I'll tell you, when that comes home to you and you realize that you deserve destruction and you're getting the provision of mercy, that becomes more valuable to you than any of the other stuff. Amen? And in that moment, there's an opportunity to not just feel forgiven, but to feel a knowing that he's Lord. I, the sovereign Lord, have spoken. Isn't that great? Ezekiel 36:11. I will increase not only the people, but also your animals. Your animals get to get a benefit out of this, right? Oh, mountains of Israel, I will bring people to live on you once again. I will make you even more prosperous than you were before and then. Isn't this amazing? Isn't this kind of cool to look at it this way? We're beholding the glory of God, aren't we, in the provision that he's making for us. Then you will know. Huh. Man, I want to take this. I want to say, there's another knowing of God that I have yet to behold. Because in that beholding, I will know even more. Amen? Aren't you glad for this? I'm glad for what I already know of God. But man, it's kind of like somebody that's studying, I don't know, any kind of technology or something. The more you get to know, the more you realize you don't know. Right? In any area of expertise, all your information is getting you is understanding that you really don't know that much, right? And that's how it should be with God too. Not that we're not secure in what we do know, but there should be this understanding, wow, I have yet to, that's why we behold and go from glory to glory, because there's more glory to know. And it's not what we've seen already, it's gonna be something else. And you have to be aware that what you are beholding is him. Sometimes, right? I think that's why he made the statements ahead of time, so that when we saw them, we would say, oh, that's not just something happening. That's God. Amen? All right, here's the part that I want to get to, because anybody can see this in these statements that were made. He's talking to anybody. When you experience what God does, you can know that he is the Lord. But if you want to have another step in this, it's intimacy with him that he wants to take us to. Yeah. That I'm not just knowing he's Lord, yes. I'm knowing he's my Lord. Yes. Amen? So So this is beholding glory and goodness. It's interesting how his goodness is wrapped up in his glory for those who get close to him. Because it's going to be a good thing for you. All right? And this is where Brandon got inspired for that song. All right. Exodus 33:18. And he said, what happened? He went up to the top of the mountain with God, right, Moses? And Moses, it's interesting to me because every one of those plagues going through the sea, it was all God's glory. And I think, man, this really defines this for us because it's not enough to just know that he's Lord and sing the song. There has to be this other side where it's, no, God, I've seen what you can do, but now I want to see you. Right? I want to see you. And this is what's so wonderful for us in Christ is we get to see him. This is what changes us from a fickle God knower to a stable one. It's not ever going to fall. It's not ever going to fall away and say, I don't really know for sure. Right? Why? Because you know him face to face. And he said, please show me your glory. Then he said, I will make all my glory pass before you. And I'll proclaim the name of the Lord before you. And I'll be gracious to whom I will be gracious. And I will have compassion on whom I will have compassion. Now, there's not a when in there. But he says, I will make all my, what? Goodness pass before you. I will actually let you know that I'm a good God. I'm a righteous God. I have judgment. I have all that stuff. But when it comes to me and you, it's good. Knowing me is a good thing. You get close to me, you're in the right spot. Amen? Leviticus 9:23. Then Moses and Aaron went into the tabernacle. Man, this is really... Remember what happened when he came down off of the mountain the first time? He'd been in the presence of God. And everybody got to see the evidence on him, right? In the New Testament, Paul talks about how that glory would fade, right? Because it's a fickle glory. You start looking at the world for a while, and the glory you beheld in him face to face can begin to fade. This is why they had a tabernacle for them to go to. And they'd go back in there and look at him some more. Right? And when they would come out of the tabernacle, it would be just like they were up on the mountain. They would have this glory on them. Then Moses and Aaron, so Aaron got to go with him, into the tabernacle. And when they came back out, they blessed the people again and the glory of the Lord. This is the part I want to get to. Is this is something we have access to continually is the glory of God. But you have to go. You have to say, I'm going to cut out a time in my life. We're talking about this in men's. You know, John Bevere was talking about this. You actually have to schedule these things. It's going to have to be something where it's important enough to me. I'm going to spend some time in his presence. Amen? Because there's something when I get face to face, there's something about knowing him that I don't get until I go there. Amen? They blessed the people again, and the glory of the Lord appeared to the whole community. This is the part I think we can take to heart, is this isn't just about me and my God. It's about me and me fulfilling my purpose on this earth by somebody else getting to see the glory of God because I have been. Does that make sense? Fire blazed forth from the Lord's presence and consumed the offering and the fat on the altar. Isn't that cool? Man, let's have a little, we're going to have to get us an altar in here. So I'm sure Larry can help us out with something. Get a barbecue thing in here. So anyway. When the people saw this, they shouted with joy and fell down on the ground. Now, It's very precious that they were influenced by what Moses and Aaron did, but the tragedy of this was they still didn't get the experience that Moses and Aaron did because they didn't get to go into that place. And this is something that Jesus came to do, is to not just have us behold the glory doing something elsewhere, but for us to be changed by it ourselves. Amen? Joshua 23, 7 through 13. This is a little bit long, so I'm going to read it quick. Oh, man. Are y'all good? Yeah. All right. Make sure you do not associate with the other people still remaining in the land. And here's the warning for us. There's something about the world that we cannot help but be influenced by. Fox News, CNN, anything, social media. As soon as we're being exposed to something other than the Word of God, other than the influence of God, there's a susceptibility to being affected by it. Does that make sense? And he said, just be really careful about this. Let me read the whole thing. I know I got stopped. Be sure you do not associate with the other people still remaining in the land. Do not even mention the names of their gods. You have to be protective of this glory. Much less swear by them or serve them or worship them or be entertained by them or watch their movies or, you know. For the Lord has driven out great and powerful nations for you, and no one has yet been able to defeat you. Each one of you will put to flight 1,000 of the enemy, for the Lord your God fights for you, just as he has promised. So be very careful to love the Lord your God. But if you turn away from him and cling to the customs of the survivors of these nations remaining among you, and if you intermarry with them, then know for certain. There's a then there, isn't there? It's kind of an inverse then. Then know, right? For certain that the Lord your God will no longer drive them out of your land. Instead, they will be a snare and a trap to you, a whip for your backs and thorny brambles in your eyes. And you will vanish from this good land the Lord your God has given you. So there's a real impetus put upon us, a real responsibility put upon us. We've been given this very precious access to the very glory of God. Now, here's the thing. We want to see the big demonstrations. But why were there demonstrations in the Old Testament? It's because somebody was spending some face-to-face time with him. Amen? There's some big things that God wants to do in this church. There's big things God wants to do in our community. But we don't follow the big things. We follow the intimacy. It's from the intimacy that the big things will flow. Amen? Because we are not bound. We're not. Those things aren't our Lord. Our Lord is face to face, amen? And from that will flow the ability for him to do these demonstrations that are going to change people's hearts, amen? I believe the healing things, Jesus went about doing good. Don't you like it, that doing good thing? That's the glory of God, isn't it? And he went about doing good and healing all that were sick, all that were afflicted. And what was the purpose of that? So that they would know, amen? They will get a demonstration of what it means to know that he's Lord. He wants to, and he said, you're going to do the same thing. But where's it going to come from? Looking for the demonstrations or looking for the intimacy? Intimacy, right? 2 Corinthians 3:15. Oh, man, are y'all good? Well, let me do this as quick as I can. All right. But even to this day, when Moses is read, a veil lies on their heart. Nevertheless, when one turns to the Lord, and here's the thing, man, we have an opportunity in this relationship we have with Jesus to experience the magnitude of this God that's all these things we've already been talking about. When we go into that closet with him, there needs to be this, wow, God, you are huge. Wow, God, you are amazing. And to be impacted by that opportunity every time. So wonderful. We have the Holy Spirit that helps us with that. But we have to be going there. We have to be pursuing that. And what's really wonderful is we're being told right now. Don't you like how God said this is what's going to happen? I'm telling you, there's a win for us in the presence of God. When we do this, we'll behold, we'll know in a way that we haven't. I want to go into my prayer time every time that now I'm going to behold him like I never have before. Amen. I'm not just regurgitating something I've already done. I'm experiencing him in a whole fresh new way. And he's not a God to be taken lightly. He's not my buddy. He's the Lord. He's a consuming fire. Now, he's good, but he's good because I'm going to him. Amen? He says, you turn away from me and it's not going to be good for you. Right? But even to the, okay. The veil lies on their heart. Nevertheless, when one turns to the Lord, the veil is taken away. Now, the Lord is the Spirit. And where the Spirit of the Lord is, there is liberty. But we all, with unveiled face, beholding as in a mirror the glory of the Lord, are being transformed into that same image from glory to glory, just as by the Spirit of the Lord. Isn't this amazing what we have in him? Oh, but there's this ever greater need for it to be an awakening of knowing every aspect of him. Not just the box we want to put him into, that we want him to do for us. Amen? All right, Romans 11, 22. Therefore, consider the goodness and the severity of God on those who fail. Severity. You know what? Those who fall, those who are judged, they know he's Lord. I don't want to be one of them. Amen. Right? I want to know him in intimacy so I don't have to know him on the other side. Yeah. Amen. Amen? If you continue in his goodness, there's the if there, right? Otherwise, you also will be cut off. Well, this doesn't sound like grace. It's the New Testament, isn't it? He's not a God that's changed. He's still the God that if you honor me, I'll honor you. You turn your back on me, you're not going to get much respect from me. Right? That's why when we get to heaven, we want him to say, well done. Not just well done, but thou good and faithful servant. Amen? Romans 2, 3. And do you think this, O man, who judge these practicing such things and doing the same, that you will escape the judgment of God? Or do you despise the riches of his goodness? So we're talking about, when we're talking about goodness, we're talking about glory, aren't we? We're talking about intimacy and glory. Because that's where the Moses example for us, right? Behold my glory, you're going to behold goodness. You despise his goodness, forbearance, and long-suffering, not knowing that it's the goodness of God that leads you to repentance. You know what the world needs to see is somebody glowing, smelling, looking like they've been in the presence of God and knowing that he's Lord. That's what's going to draw them. As much as he's a God of judgment, that's not the message. Right? As much as he's a God of power, that's not the message. He's a God of goodness. He loves you before you ever look his way. He's already forgiven you before you've ever asked for it. Amen? And that's what they need to hear. But they're going to hear it from somebody. You can't just share goodness that you haven't been experiencing. You have to be experiencing that. Oh, I'm telling you what. You can remain in his presence and savoring every moment because he's good. Amen? We're not just talking about a concept. He's not just a fig Newton. He's real. Amen? All right, one more. I'm just going to make you listen to the whole thing, all right? 2 Thessalonians 1:11. Therefore, we also pray always for you, and this is really good. We're praying for what happens when we pray? It's going to make an effect, isn't it? That our God would count you worthy of this calling. We've been called to this, haven't we? This is a holy calling. To be in the presence, to know, to be changed from glory to glory, beholding him. To be changed into his image in this place of intimacy. And fulfill all the good pleasure. There's that goodness again, right? Of his goodness and the work of faith with power. That means there's demonstrations of knowing that he's Lord that will happen as we're faithful to the calling. Amen? That the name of our Lord Jesus Christ may be glorified in you. And you in him. Isn't that wonderful? It goes both ways. God's glorified by us. Isn't that amazing? And you and him, according to the grace. All right, there's that grace word. Grace is actually working in this. Amen? You can't put grace in a box and say this is all it does. No, it enables us in holiness. It enables us in the beholding of his glory. Amen. Father, we